I'm David Yak here.
And I'm Susan Kellerhorn.
And you're listening to Yak About Today. And for those of you that have been listening for the last 8 years, you always expect me to say, hey, David Yak here, you're listening to Yak About Today, where you never know where the show will go. Put your headphones on, go for a run. Now, here's the problem. There are two problems here, Susan.
Oh, no, not two.
One is, we do know where we're going today, and we're going to be talking about film. And the second thing is, I keep saying, put your headphones on, go for a run, but now we're on video. So, I don't know what to do here, folks. So, if you'll kindly write us a new opening, that would be greatly appreciated. Just post it on our Facebook page, and, you know, we'll try one of them. Anyway, Susan, so, we've got a great show. It's packed. Right, we got two fabulous guests, but we are starting off with something I think is fabulous, and that is when we were talking about doing something special on the, you know, for the festival, we said, wouldn't it be great to show morning cartoons? And you know, our great friend Jill, who's sitting in the studio, so she says, I think I can get in touch with the sons of Myron Waldman. And I said, I'm sorry, but who is Myron Waldman? I should know this name. It sounds familiar. And she says, he created Popeye and Betty Boop and Superman. And I went, wow, because we may very well be the last generation that was raised on Betty Boop, Superman, and Popeye.
Don't forget Casper the Friendly Ghost.
Oh, my fave, my fave.
I know. I lived on that Saturday morning.
I loved it. I loved it. Anyway, we got the brothers here, Rob Waldman and Steve Waldman. And Rob, first to you, tell me something. So you're growing up with one of the great animators, probably, you know, one of the beginning animators in history. Any influence? Any rub off there? Are you doing anything? Do you know how to draw? Rob, that's for you.
That's me. Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
And yeah, can you see me now? Yeah, I'm really good with TV cameras and cars. But I have to tell you, when I was 10 years old, my dad was working on a cartoon. And it was a cartoon about a mouse that went into space. Or was it a cat? It was a cat. It was a cat in space. The cartoon was called Planet Mouseola. And I noticed when he was working on the storyboards that the name of the rocket ship was Feline One. And I said, gee, Dad, you know, they called, I was a real follower of the space program. And I said, gee, Dad, they called why don't you call it Catalyst? The name of the booster on the rockets that they use at Cape Canaveral is Atlas. And he cleared it with Paramount, and Paramount said, yeah, that's a great name for it. So that was my, at 10 years old, I got my first paid writing. I got 50 cents for it, and ended up becoming a writer and teller. That's how I met Jill. We worked at CNBC together in the long form documentary unit. And yeah, so I used to put it on my resume when I had very few credits on my resume when I was in my 20s. And they would see this gap. It would go 1960 and then jump to 1974. So it was an eye catcher at first. Yeah, it was great growing up with Dad as a, he was a cartoonist. Always using his art in his life. I mean, we had, when people would come over, he would draw menus. And he called our house Mildew Manor. So it was a lot of fun. It was great to have a dad who, and all the animals, you know, we had squirrels in the backyard. They had names like cartoon characters. I thought we really had squirrels named Seymour and Julius. That was their name. And they were the same ones that showed up every day. So.
Hey, Steve. Tell me something. You know, a lot of things are being recreated today, you know, from the old days. Of course, Superman has gone on through the years. I think Popeye was made into a movie with Robin Williams. right? Is there any interest in going back and really creating new storylines and new animations and new movies with the original characters like Betty Boop?
Well, personally, I don't really watch all that. I just like watching what my dad did. To me, the modern stuff isn't like the way it was done years ago. I'm kind of nostalgic. So I kind of shy away from the modern things. I saw the Popeye. I thought the Popeye was good at Robin Williams, but I haven't really stayed with a lot of that stuff. Not really into the new stuff. Dad would be kind of like, it was better when we did it.
Right. And Rob, you know, I was watching the Betty Boop cartoons last night, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
And two things. One is a little bit risque, wouldn't you say, for the time? I mean, this is a long time ago. It seems like this, you know, I think we talked about it earlier. So,
Yes. Pre-production code, which comes out in 1934, the cartoons are very racy. I mean, you would even say that Betty would have a case in the Me Too movement to complain. And the animators, and animators, Dad was very reserved as an animator. Some of these guys were really crazy. I mean, they were wild. And there are a couple of cartoons pre-code where the guys thought it would be funny if when Betty's skirt lifts up, she wasn't wearing any panties. And in these days of freeze frame, you can see that they went a little too far.
All right.
A little
this
too
is
far
the
with that.
Last question for either of you. So I know it, your dad's favorite film, I think, is A Language All My Own. It's about Betty Boop going to Japan. I'm particularly enamored with that, with the video. The way he took the car onto the plane and then the car slid off and then the plane flew off, I think was genius, genius animation.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about that. We got about a minute to go, I think.
Steve, you want to take it?
I was going to talk about how he studied the Japanese language because he was very, very careful. He was always afraid of, with the fans, that it would be the wrong gesture. It would be like, you know, some kind of sexual innuendo. He was very, very careful with that.
Yes,
and
he went up to...
Go ahead.
Want me to finish it?
Japanese restaurant, and then he got acquainted with the... Well, how does it go, Rob? You know better than I do.
He went up to the international house at Columbia
That's
University,
right.
met with
right.
Japanese students, and showed them some of the pencil work, the preliminary stuff, to make sure that none of the gestures that Betty did with the fan were at all obscene.
Right.
And so he checked. He loved that cartoon. And it really is. And I'm sure the gag with the plane coming down and the car going on it was Dad's idea, because he was always, even into his 90s, he was always coming up with great sight gags.
It was his gag. He told me that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
That was his sight gag. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Hey, guys, I can't thank you enough for being on the show
today.
Oh,
you're welcome.
I mean, we loved it. We're big fans. I think we're the last generation that actually grew up with your dad's characters. So I really appreciate you coming on. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Okay.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Next time.
All right. Before we go to break, I want to thank New Vision Eye Center. I've been talking about them for a long time. They've been sponsoring the show for a long time, and we really appreciate it. They make it possible, and that's why I always say go to New Vision Eye Center, because I wouldn't trust my eyes to anyone else.
Welcome back to Yak About, where we're talking about the Vero Beach Film Festival, and we've invited filmmakers from all our films to come on our show, and today we're having Jada Poon. But before I introduce Jada, I want to tell you the film festival is going to be June 9th through 12th. It's going to be 4 days of amazing films, fun parties. You're going to have a great time. So you can get your tickets at vbfilmfest.org. They're really great. They're going to be, there's all types of options. You can go from buying a 4-film pass to buying all the way up to every party, every film, everything that you can possibly go to and have 4 days of never stopping. So now I'd like to introduce you to Jada Poon. Hi, Jada. How are you?
Hello. Hi, Jada. Good, good. How are you?
I'm really glad. I'm glad to welcome you. You're in the student film category, and you have a really unique film. It's a whimsical coming of age film, but it's a tough topic and it's very interesting. How did it come about?
It's funny because I was in my screenwriting class in junior year where everyone is male, including teachers, and I was the only girl. I was having my period. I was depressed. So I want everyone to feel how it felt like and want to make them kind of uncomfortable, but also funny, hopefully. And that's how I started writing Code Red.
Oh, that's great. And you didn't just want to do that, though. You wanted to kind of talk about period poverty and tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, so the story kind of evolved into a branded entertainment story because we found out as I do more research that really period poverty is a problem that happens across the globe, including in the US, where 4 out of 5 girls or students who menstruate they would either skip class or school just because they couldn't have access to menstrual products.
I actually know that almost every woman listening here can totally relate to that, having something happen, whether it was period poverty or just the lack of accessibility. How do you feel guys have been accepting your film?
I think it has been having a good receptions among all genders, especially guys, because it's something that they haven't seen before. Like, women were like, yeah, we know what it's like. And then it's like, oh, I can relate to that. But then for guys, because now they see how it's like visually with a visual metaphor, then they'd be like, oh, and they're having much more reactions from it. So somehow I'm having more laughters from them. Yeah.
You know, this is David. Hey, how are you?
Good, good. How are you?
So it's interesting because Susan just asked the question. So when we're looking at the videos that we're going to accept, and this video was presented to me, I was watching it, and my first reaction was, oh, is this going to be good for our audience? I think it's sort of pushing it. And then when I spoke to Susan and I spoke to Jill, our partner and board secretary, oh, they were delighted with the film. They were saying, this is a necessary film. Everybody should see it. And honestly, I was blushing.
It's funny, though. I mean, we don't want to scare people. The film has some funny moments. It's really cute. Your actors are adorable. How did you find them?
It's a long quest because we're posting all in the Facebook groups that I can find regarding like Florida castings. And I was able to find my actors that's like 3 hours drive away from my location. And I was very lucky to have them able to commit to the story because I actually casted them in the early 2020s. And we're supposed to go into production in March, but obviously you know what happened and they stick with us and we're able to use our same main cast in August of 2021.
That's awesome. So COVID really did affect your ability to film.
Yes, absolutely.
You actually had to film this after you graduated. It was your senior thesis, correct?
Mm-hmm. It was. And I was able to have my department support to bring me back to Florida to finish my thesis film finally. And hopefully people like it.
How does it work with student films? How are they financed? Are you financed? Are you given resources from the school to do the film? Are you given the equipment to do the film?
Mm-hmm. So the good thing about Ringling College of Fine Design is that we have all the equipment we need to make the film happen. We have the cameras, we have the sound equipment, we even have the post-production facilities that we're able to use to sound mix it afterward and edit it, obviously. And so I was lucky enough to have that support from Ringling, but also we're able to contact our donors of the school itself who might be interested in the story, that we're able to fundraise enough capitals to bring me and the fellow alumni who have graduated and moved out of town back to Sarasota to make the story happen. And with the whole crew that we have, it's all from my school. So they're either graduates or like still students or people of my year.
And there are so many different disciplines necessary to make a film. Sorry. Mm-hmm. So you have your director. Are there different programs that are teaching people to edit, people to do the cinematography, to direct, mm-hmm. or is it one program where you sort of study a little by little of each?
At Ringling, it's one program that you study all aspects of filmmaking. So until junior year, you're actually doing all the roles and you're making films every year and every weekend. And in senior year, you're actually able to choose your focus that you want to go into. So I was doing directing, producing, and assistant directing. And we're focused on doing those particular roles in bigger projects. And because of that, we were able to like do a bit more exploration of what we like doing and get a bit more in-depth when we are graduating.
I'm assuming that you want to be a filmmaker as you move forward. What's the process? Is submitting to all the different festivals gets the film out there and you're hoping to be recognized for a specific talent?
Yes, hopefully people like my voice and like how I tell stories. And going to festivals really, for me, at least for Code Red, this project itself, because I put in so much love and heart and everyone's effort into it, I would love to show it to as many people as possible. And if there are festivals that I can attend, that will be places that I would be able to network, hopefully. If I couldn't, then at least that would be a chance for my crew or my producers to go as well, for them to at least network and expand their circles to hopefully finding the next job after they graduate. And
so, yeah. I'm sorry. One of the things that I realized is we did not ask you a little bit about the background of the story. Can you tell the story a little bit that you're sharing with us?
So Code Red itself is a whimsical coming of age of a 6 years old, is a whimsical coming of age of a sixth grade Carmen who has appeared for the first time, that she and her best friend has to go and search for a pad in school.
And
that's the David, plan.
I'm sorry. Do you have plans already for the next film? Have you started working on a script for the next film?
Yes, I have. I am hoping to write a series of a comedy kind of dramedy that I'm still developing the whole world for it, but it will be fun.
But now that you've graduated, what are you doing career-wise? Like, what I know you're working on films, but what are you doing beyond that?
So after I graduated Ringling, I moved to Toronto. So currently I'm based in Toronto, Canada. And I'm freelancing mostly, that I'm doing production coordinating, assistant directing on indie films or like TV shows. And I've gotten into the Directors Guild of Canada as a program for SAPAs on training the assistant directing department. So I am hopefully making a living from doing different roles, but also making my own projects in my free time.
Well, we can't thank you enough. We look forward. You are coming to the festival. I didn't hear.
Not sure yet.
Okay. Well, we do hope you come, and we really enjoy talking to you. And if you come, we can't wait to meet you. And we thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jada.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. So, Susan, we need to talk about the festival.
Yes, we absolutely do.
Right? And again, I just hope you don't mind that we're going to repeat this, but the festival is June 9th through 12th, and we think we have some great plans. We certainly have a great lineup of films for you. Our documentaries are, I think, extraordinary. The films we picked, we're hoping you'll go to the website and you'll buy tickets. That's how we keep moving forward. If you go to vbfilmfest.org, you'll see a place to buy tickets, and we have tickets at all price ranges. So don't shy away from it. Try to pick something that you find affordable. And I think it's the pick four we can see.
The pick four, it's $55. It's $55. You can see four movies. And we have the Cinema Select, which is $175, I believe, that you can see all the films. You'll be also included in the opening party as well as our closing party. Tickets for the actual events will go on sale. So if you buy one type of pass but want to attend some of our events, those will be available Wednesday before the festival. We're having this wonderful pre-party. It's going to be a dinner party. It's going to include all kinds of things. If you've ever been to any of our parties, you know we throw the best parties in town. We're also looking for home hosts for our filmmakers. We invite our filmmakers to come to town. We want them to stay with families here so that they have an opportunity to get to know Vero for what Vero really is. We do give you a benefit for hosting hosting a filmmaker, and we also are looking for volunteers in all sorts of capacities. So anything from fundraising to marketing to doing to actually working at the festival, we'll definitely need a lot of volunteers to work at the festival. So we'll be announcing on our website, vbfilmfest.org, volunteer opportunities. We have a volunteer website that you can sign up for. And it tells you everything we've got available, and we hope to see you at the festival. We hope to have you buy tickets. We hope that you are volunteering. We hope that you're hosting family filmmakers, and we look forward to seeing you at the film festival.
And one more thing before we go and say goodbye, and that is we also live on sponsorship. And so we're hoping people and businesses in the local community will support us. And by the way, the email address, if you're interested in working with us or supporting us, is info@vbfilmfest.org. That's info@vbfilmfest.org. And we look forward to hearing from you. And by the way, we're on Facebook now. We are on video. It's the first time for us in 8 years for the Yakabout series. So we hope to see you again, and we'll let you know when when we are on live, because then we can take your calls and we can text with you and do all the things that Facebook allows. Thanks, Susan.
Thanks, David.
I love working with you.
I know, it's so much fun.
It is. So take care, everybody.
Bye. Don't.